Good day. In this session, we will be discussing about bioavailability and bioequivalence. Myself, Dr. Prabhjot Singh, Associate Professor, Pharmaceutics Department, Chaudhary Devi Lal College of Pharmacy, Haryana, India. Bioavailability is defined as the rate and extent to which the active ingredient or active moiety is absorbed from a drug product and becomes available at the site of action. So bioavailability, when a drug is given by IV route, the bioavailability is 100%, and when a drug is given by other routes other than IV route, the bioavailability decreases due to various factors such as first pass metabolism and lack in absorption, degradation of drug by the stomach enzymes, etc. Bioavailability data provide an estimate of the fraction of drug absorbed from the formulation and provide information about the pharmacokinetics of the drug. Absolute bioavailability compares the bioavailability of the active drug in systemic circulation following extravascular administration with the bioavailability of the same drug following intravenous administration. That is the comparison of bioavailability of two dosage forms or two routes is compared. One is IV and other is extravascular. IV route is considered to be 100% bioavailable, while other extravascular routes have less bioavailability than the IV route. The other extravascular routes are the oral route, the transdermal route, etc. The equation that can be used to calculate the absolute bioavailability is given. The FABS, which is the absolute bioavailability, is equal to AUC of oral into dose of IV divided by AUC of IV into dose of oral. In relative bioavailability, the comparison of our reference formulation A is done with the test formulation B. The reference formulation can be a pre-approved drug or a solution, oral solution form, or any other reference drug, while the test formulation is the drug that is to be tested. The formula that can be used to calculate the relative bioavailability is FREL is equal to 100 into AUC of A into dose of B divided by AUC of B into dose of A. A is the reference formulation and B is the test formulation. Before moving further, we must understand what is NDA and ANDA. NDA means new drug application. When a new drug is developed, and the manufacturer or the developer, which we can say also say sponsor of a new drug, believes that enough evidence on the drug safety and effectiveness has been obtained to meet the FDA's requirement for marketing approval, the sponsor submits to the FDA a new drug application. FDA is the regulatory body that governs the drugs approvals in the United States. While ANDA means abbreviated new drug application, an abbreviated new drug application contains data that, when submitted to FDA, provides for the review and ultimate approval of a generic drug product. Generic drug applications are called abbreviated because they are not required to include preclinical, animal, and clinical human data to establish safety and effectiveness, because that has been already done by the original manufacturer who has filed the NDA. Instead, a generic applicant must scientifically demonstrate that its product is bioequivalent, that is, performs in the same manner as the original drug. Bioavailability studies are drug product performance studies used to define the effect of changes in the physicochemical properties of the drug substance, the formulation of the drug, and the manufacture process of the drug product, that is the dosage form. Bioavailability is one aspect aspect of drug product quality that links the in vivo performance of a new drug product to the original formulation that was used in the clinical safety and efficacy studies. While bioequivalence studies are drug product performance tests that compare the bioavailability of the same active pharmaceutical ingredient from one drug product, that is test formulation, to a second drug product, that is a reference formulation. Bioavailability and bioequivalence can be considered as measures of the drug product performance in vivo. Bioequivalence is a property when two drugs with identical active ingredients or two different dosage forms of the same drug possess similar bioavailability and produce the same effect at the site of physiological activity. A bioequivalence study is a specialized type of relative bioavailability study. Bioavailability and bioequivalence data play pivotal roles in regular submission for marketing, approval of new and generic drugs throughout the world. Bioequivalence studies are used to compare the bioavailability of the same drug, same salt or ester from various drug products. So equivalence, it is a relative term that compares drug product with respect to specific characteristic or function or to defined set of standards. There are several type of equivalence: chemical equivalence, pharmaceutical equivalence and bioequivalence. Objectives of bioavailability studies. Bioavailability studies are important in the number one, primary stages of development of a suitable dosage form for a new drug entity. The new drug should be sufficiently bioavailable to elicit a pharmacological response. Second, determination of influence of excipients, patient-related factors, and possible interactions with other drugs on the efficiency of absorption. It has been found that many of the excipients, some patient-related factors, and some interaction with other drugs also affect the absorption of drugs. Third, the development of a new formulation of existing drugs. When the manufacturer has to develop a new formulation, that is, one has to go from a, for example, a conventional tablet to a controlled-release formulation or a transdermal patch, etc. He has to show that the bioavailability of a new formulation is equal to that of the original formulation that has been approved by the FDA. Fourth, control of quality of drug product during early stages of marketing in order to determine the influence of processing factors, storage, and stability on drug absorption. It has been found that some drugs, when stored for a long period of time, their absorption decreases. So for such changes, we have to determine the bioavailability of the drug after storage. Measurement of bioavailability. There are two methods which can be used for the determination of bioavailability. First is a pharmacokinetic method. Second is the pharmacodynamic method. First, we will discuss about pharmacokinetic methods. These are very, very widely used and based on the assumption that pharmacokinetic profile reflects the therapeutic effectiveness of a drug. The pharmacokinetic methods are of two types. One are the plasma level time studies. Second are the urinary excretion studies. Plasma level time studies. Unless determination of plasma drug concentration is difficult or impossible, it is the most reliable method and method of choice in comparison to urine data. With single dose study, the method requires collection of serial blood samples for a period of 2 to 3 biological half-lives after drug administration, their analysis for drug concentration, and making a plot of concentration versus corresponding time of sample collection to obtain the plasma level time profile. So from the graph of time versus the low concentration, we can determine the various pharmacokinetic parameters. three of these parameters are most important. First is the Cmax. It is the peak plasma concentration or the maximum plasma drug concentration obtained after oral administration of drug. Second is the Tmax. It is the time at which the Cmax is reached. Third is the area under the curve. The area under the plasma level time curve is the measurement of the extent of drug bioavailability. The extent of bioavailability can be calculated using the following equations. F, that is the bioavailability, is equal to AUC of oral into dose of IV divided by AUC of IV into dose of oral. The relative bioavailability can be determined using the equation AUC test into dose of standard divided by AUC standard into dose of test. Second method is urinary excretion studies. This method is used when the plasma data is not available. This method of assessing bioavailability is based on the principle that the urinary excretion of unchanged drug is directly proportional to the plasma concentration of drug. Thus, even if a drug is excreted to some extent, at least 10 to 20% in the urine, bioavailability can be determined. The study is particularly useful for drugs extensively excreted unchanged in the urine, for example, certain thiazide diuretics and sulfonamides, and for drugs that have urine as the site of action, for example, urinary antiseptics such as nitrofurantoin and hexamine. The method involves collection of urine at regular intervals for a time span equal to 7 biological half-lives, analysis of unchanged drug in the collected sample, and determination of the amount of drug excreted in each interval and cumulative amount excreted. The parameters which are of most importance are dxu by dt, that is the rate of drug excretion. Because most drugs are eliminated by first order rate process, the rate of drug excretion is dependent on the first order elimination rate constant K and the concentration of drug in plasma Cp. T infinity, the total time for drug to be excreted. Xu, the cumulative amount of drug excreted in urine. It is analogous to AUC of plasma level time studies. The extent of bioavailability using urinary excretion studies can be calculated using following equations. Absolute bioavailability F can be calculated using the equation F is equal to xu infinity, that is the cumulative amount of drug excreted unchanged in urine of oral into dose of IV divided by cumulative amount of drug excreted in urine of IV dose into dose of oral. And the relative bioavailability can be calculated using equation FR is equal to xu infinity of test into dose of standard divided by xu infinity standard into dose of test. These are the corresponding plots relating the plasma level time curve A and the cumulative urinary drug excretion B. Now we will be discussing about pharmacodynamic methods. These methods are complementary to pharmacokinetic approaches and involve direct measurement of drug effect on pathophysiologic processes as a function of time. The two pharmacodynamic methods involve determination of bioavailability from number one, acute pharmacological response and therapeutic response. Acute pharmacologic response. When bioavailability measurement by pharmacokinetic method is difficult, inaccurate or non-reproducible, an acute pharmacological effect such as a change in ECG or EEG readings, pupil diameter, etc. is related to the time course of given drug. Bioavailability can then be determined by construction of pharmacologic effect time curve as well as dose response graphs. The method requires measurement of responses for at least 3 biological half-lives of the drug in order to obtain a good estimates of AUC. A disadvantage of this method is that the pharmacologic response tends to be more variable and accurate correlation between measured response and drug available from the formulation is difficult. So, summarizing the acute pharmacological response method, the dose is compared with the pharmacologic effect, such as change in the electrocardiogram graph or EEG. Therapeutic response is theoretically the most definite. This method is based on observing the clinical response to drug formulation given to patients suffering from disease for which it is intended to be used. A major drawback of this method is that quantitation of observed response is too improper to allow for reasonable assessment of relative bioavailability between two dosage forms of the same drug. So in therapeutic response, we see that what is the ultimate effect of the drug on body. That is, if we give drug to relieve patient from pain, so we must see that the drug relieves the patient from the pain. Bioequivalence studies. Bioequivalence is established if the in vivo bioavailability of a test drug product, usually the generic product, does not differ significantly from that of the reference listed drug, usually the brand name product approved through the NDA route, in the product's rate and extent of drug absorption. Bioequivalence is determined by comparison of measured parameters, example, concentration of active drug ingredients in the blood, urinary excretion rates, or pharmacodynamic effects when administered at the same molar dose of the active moiety under similar experimental conditions, either single dose or multiple dose. When is bioequivalence not necessary? That is, biowaivers. The bioequivalence studies are not necessary when parenteral solution of the same active substance with the same concentration, same excipients are manufactured. Oral solutions of the same active substance with same concentration, excipients not affecting GI transit or absorptions are manufactured. For gas formulations, for powder for reconstitution as solution, otic, ophthalmic, topical solution, same active substances with same concentration, same excipients. That is, the formulations which are same in various aspects as the pre-approved formulation. So next is the design of bioequivalence studies. The basic design for bioequivalence study is determined by, number one, the scientific questions and objectives to be answered, the nature of the reference material and the dosage form to be tested, the availability of analytical methods, the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamics of the drug substance, the route of drug administration, benefit, risk, and ethical consideration with regard to testing in humans. So, on the basis of these 6 points, a bioequivalence study is designed. Once bioequivalence is established, it is likely that both the generic and brand name dosage form will produce the same therapeutic effect. The FDA publishes guidances for bioequivalence studies. Sponsors may also request a meeting with the FDA to review the study design for a specific drug product. For bioequivalence studies, the test and reference drug formulations must contain the same drug in the same dose strength and similar dosage forms. Example, immediate release or controlled release, and must be given by the same route of administration. Before beginning the study, the institutional review board of the clinical facility in which the study is to be performed must approve the study. Generally, the study is performed in normal healthy male and female volunteers who have given informed consent to be in the study. Critically ill patients are not included in an in vivo study unless the attending physician determines that there is a potential benefit to the patient. The number of subjects in the study will depend on the expected inter subject and intra subject variability. So we should also know what is a reference listed drug or RLD. For bioequivalence studies of generic products, one formulation of drug is chosen as a reference standard against which all other formulations of the drugs are compared. The FDA designates a single reference listed drug as standard drug product to which all generic version must be shown to be bioequivalent. Before beginning an in vivo bioequivalence study, the total content of active drug substance in the test product, generally the generic product, must be within 5% of that of the reference product. The guidance for designing a study is given by FDA. Generally, two equivalent studies are required for solid oral dosage forms, including a fasting study and a food intervention study. In a fasting study, the study is done under fasting conditions, that is, the subjects are not allowed to take food, and in the food intervention study, the subjects are allowed to take food. Next are the crossover study designs. A complete crossover design is usually employed in which each subject receives the test drug product and reference product. Crossover word means that crossover is done, that is, first the subject receives first treatment, then the second treatment. Subjects who meet the inclusion and exclusion study criteria and have given informed consent are selected at random. That is, the number is assigned to each subject randomly. The number can be assigned as 1, 2, 3, 4 randomly. Then the first type of crossover design is the Latin square crossover design. Examples of Latin square crossover designs for bioequivalence study in human volunteer comparing three different formulation A, B, C will be studied. The Latin square design plans the clinical trial so that each subject receives each drug product only once, with adequate time between medication for the elimination of the drug from the body. In this design, each subject is his own control and subject to subject variation is reduced. Moreover, variation due to sequence, period and treatment are reduced so that all patients do not receive the same drug product on the same day and in the same order. After each subject receives a drug product, blood samples are collected at appropriate time intervals so that a valid blood drug level time curve is obtained. Period refers to time period in which a study is performed. A two-period study is a study that is performed on two different days, time periods separated by a washout period during which most of the drug is eliminated from the body, generally about 10 elimination half-lives. So as we can see from the table shows a Latin square crossover design for bioequivalence study of three drug products in six human volunteers. The human volunteers have been given name as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then there are the three study periods are shown in this study. First is the study period 1. Second is the study period 2. Third is the study period 3. So the treatments given are in the order that the first subject, that is subject number 1, is first given the A treatment in the study period 1. Then in study period 2, it's given B treatment, and in the study period 3 is given the C treatment. So between each period there is a washout period of about 10 elimination half-lives. Similarly, the other subjects are also given the treatment. So the second subject is given first given the treatment in first study period A, B, in second study period C, and in third study period A. So this is a Latin square crossover design for bioequivalence study of three drug products in six human volunteers. A sequence refers to the number of different orders in treatment groups in a study. So, sequence is the sequence in which the subject receives the treatment. So, sequence 1 is that in the period 1, T, that is treatment is given to the patient, and in period 2, the reference drug is given to the patient. In the second sequence, in period 1, the reference is given first, and in period 2, the treatment is given second. So, that is the sequence. Next is a replicated crossover study design. The standard bioequivalence criterion used in the two-way crossover design does not give an estimate of within subject, that is intra-subject variability. By giving the same drug product twice to the same subject, the replicate design provides a measure for within subject variability. Replicate design studies may be used for highly variable drugs and for narrow therapeutic index drugs. A four-period, two-sequence, two-formulation design is shown below. So, in the sequence 1, in period 1, the subject will be given treatment. In period 2, he will be given reference. In period 3, he will be given again treatment. And in period 4, he will be given again reference. So, each subject is, the drug is given twice to the same subject. In sequence 2, the period 1, the drug is given reference. In period 2, drug given is test. In period 3, the drug given is reference. And in period 4, the drug given is treatment or the test. So, in replicated crossover study design, the intra-subject variability is reduced. Next are the parallel study designs. A non-replicate parallel design is used for drug products that contain drugs that have a long elimination half-life or drug products such as depot injections in which the drug is slowly released over weeks or months. So for such drugs which have a very long half-life, the washout period will be very long. That is, if a drug has a half-life of say 1 month, then for its complete elimination from the body, that is 10 half-lives, we have to take 10 months. That will be time for a very long study. So, in this design, two separate group of volunteers are used. One group will be given the test product and other group will be given the reference product. It is important to balance the demographics of both groups of the volunteers. Demographic means their ages, their sexes, their weights should be same. Blood sample collection time should be adequate to ensure completion of gastrointestinal transit approximately 2 to 3 days of the drug product and absorption of the drug substance.